with Windows Server 2012, 2012 R2, we got a stack of commandlets. But, pardon?
Louder.
That better?
Yep.
Right. My voice does tend to go quiet, so if you can't hear me, please shout. Might wake me up if nothing else. So with Server 2012, 2012 R2, we got a whole bunch of commandlets. The one bit that was missing, what didn't we get commandlets for? We didn't get commandlets for the registry. So what I'm going to show you today is a way to generate some commandlets yourself using the commandlets over objects, the CDXML approach that has been used for so many of the commandlets that are already in the product. So if you've not met me already, my name's Richard Sidaway.
Did you push the button?
I did push the button. Thank you. I'm PowerShell MVP for a number of years, director of PowerShell.org, helped organize this event, written a couple of books and blog and whatever. So if we're working with the registry, we've got a provider, we've got WMI. How many people like WMI? Yay, how many people hate WMI? Yay. Right, the problem with WMI is it's more than a little bit painful to work with sometimes, even with PowerShell. So if we can wrap it up and make it easier to use, everybody's gonna be happy. So that's about it for the slides.
Next presentation,
yeah. So we've got this stregprov class, and you will notice that it doesn't have very many properties. It's all methods. And it lives in root SIMB2, where most of our helpful classes live. In XP and 2003, it was also available in root default, but we'll skip over that, we don't care. Only methods. And they're all static methods, so we don't need to actually create an instance. I'll make all of these available to you at the end. And all of the classes have got a set of parameters with wonderful intuitive names, and it makes life so much easier to use, especially when you look at things like the def key and the numbers and the values that it's expecting. How many people can remember those? Nobody? Yeah, not surprised. So it's always easier to set them as variables. We'll set subkey to play with, and we'll set something that we want to go. So if we start with a little bit of history, a long time ago we had PowerShell 1. It does seem like an awful long time ago, but we've come an awful long way since then. So you had to use the WMI class type accelerator. Anybody still using the type accelerators? Yeah? Congratulations, have a book. And you could basically get yourself an object with all of the stuff that you need. And then you can just call it and use it, and you get a nice return value of 0, you get the value. As you know, with WMI, return value of 0 is good. You're all happy. If you get anything else but good, you're tearing your hair out trying to find out what's gone wrong, because the documentation for WMI is a little inconsistent, if it's there. And that's one of the big problems with it, is the lack of documentation on some of the classes. So you can then get the value and you're all good to go. Or you can concatenate it and do it like that. Then we got PowerShell V2, and we went from one WMI commandlet to many WMI commandlets. And we looked at that, and we said, this is great. And we started using it. So if you've used invoke WMI method, you just need the namespace, the class, and give it the method name and a set of arguments. You can use the same variables that we used before, and that goes off and works. But isn't there always a but? WMI or invoke WMI method can give us a few problems with the parameters that we're putting into the method. And I'll show you what I mean. So if we look at creating a key in the registry, we have a very imaginatively named create key. And we'll create a value and set it to April 2013, and that's all worked, and we can just check it, it's all good. Now let's modify this. So we'll set a new value. It's worked. Well, it seemed to have worked. Right, so I got return codes of zero all the way through that. The problem is in the parameter names, that's the order that they're listed in the documentation. If you use them in that order, it'll all go wrong. Normally, you get an error because you'll end up with a type mismatch, and it will throw a numeric error at you, which is that code down at the there to say that it's got a mismatch on the type. That's the way you usually trip over this. And the reason for it is the order of the parameters has to be in the way in in alphabetical order. So the way to check that is to use the sim class, and that will give you the right order. So ignore the documentation, use sim class. So if you retry with them the other way around, which is counterintuitive but does work, and then you can see that one picks up. In PowerShell 3 and later, we got typing without hands. We got the same commandlets. They took that problem away because you're giving key value pairs with the name of the parameter and the value, which in one respect makes life an awful lot easier. In another respect, is a pain because you've got to do an awful lot more typing. And if you sat there coding all day, the last thing you want is something that invokes more typing. There's got to be a better way. Yeah, I was definitely on a Star Wars theme when I was playing with this. What you want really is something like this. So you've got a module with a whole bunch of commandlets in that will allow you to access the method directly and easily, and allow you to do something like this. So you can just tell it the hive, you can give it the subkey and the value name, and you're good to go. Or that you can just give it a new value. We're getting ahead of ourselves, but that conference is approaching rapidly. More work. And we'll just tidy that up. Right, so how do we do all that? The answer is that we use the CDXML, and we basically take the WMI class, wrap it in a tiny little bit of XML, and we're good to go. We've got a PowerShell module. And it looks like this. This is the Win32 BIOS class, which you can see up here. The first two lines are just headers. just header stuff, and they're always there. You've got the class name, you've got a version number, that's arbitrary, you can change that as you want. You're giving it a default noun so that it produces a commandlet, and then that gives you this little bit, gives you the get command, or puts the verb on it. And we'll just look at this in action. And so that code, that XML that I showed you, so that XML gives you a CDXML file, which you import as a standard module, and it gives you the commandlet get BIOS, and you can just use it as such. Now that, for a junior admin, is a lot easier to use than WMI. And you can wrap whatever else you want in the similar manner to make commandlets for your junior admins, for yourself, make life a lot easier. This is all about ease of use. It just makes WMI that much easier to use and quicker to use, because it fits in with the way that you're doing everything else. And we'll just compare it, standard output, exactly the same output, you're outputting exactly the same objects. So all of the formatting that you get now, you will get through the CDMX module. And if you do the format list star, you get everything. You also get some freebies. Freebies are always good. So if you think back to the code that I showed, that is very simple piece of XML. There's nothing in there about sim sessions. There's nothing in there about jobs. There's nothing in there about the common parameters that you expect to see on PowerShell modules. They're all there. The system does the work for you. So without any more effort on your part, it automatically works over sim sessions, it automatically works as a job, and you've got the standard common parameters. And just to prove that, okay, I'm going to the local machine, but it does work. I've did a session back in 2012, I think it was with the logical disk class. That code will be available as a further example. So let's go back to thinking about the registry. So we'll start with this. Now this gets a little bit more complicated, but not by much. So you've already seen this first bit. It's just a different class. I give it a different noun. And I put this bit in static commandlets. If you dig through the white paper that was published about this, it basically comes down to instance commandlets, where it's something like win32_process, where you've got instances of the class, and static commandlets, where you're using static methods. The other one that I mentioned, the disk one, that uses the instance commandlet, so you'll see an example of both in the code that I'll leave you. You need to give it a verb, a noun, the method name, which you saw from the sim class, the type of data that you're expecting for return, and then you describe the parameters. And if you remember stpridgeprof, subkey name, value, again you're giving it a type. You can change the name, so the name that the commandlet uses doesn't exactly have to be the same as the WMI name. When you're putting these together, just remember to get those the right way around, otherwise it does get very confusing. And you can basically set those to what works for you. And that's it. Couple of drawbacks. One, there isn't an easy tool to generate this, so copy and paste is your friend. Secondly, you have to do this for each of the methods that you want to put in. So having seen the code, see it in action. So this is what I've just gone through. So there's the header information, the definition, and the parameter definition. And to use the new commandlet, we'll just define the variables again. Import module. I've got all of these in the same folder, which is why I'm implicitly importing them. If you've get to the end of one of these development cycles on these, you just put it on your module path and it auto loads for you. You don't need to explicitly import it. So you get the registry string commandlet that we defined, freebies we've mentioned already. It works with get command and all of the other things. If you want to create these and you want to generate some help for them, you can't use inline help, the inline comment help. You've got to create a standard XML help file, external help file. And then we just use it, which is a little bit easier than using the WMI class. I've chosen to bring the return value back. You don't need to. If you basically decide that you don't need that, you can drop the return of that out and just get your values back. Okay, so you still need to use that horrible big number to define the hive. I can never remember those, so it'd be much easier and nicer to use HKLM or whatever. Right, so this is 2. And the way we do that is on the parameter, we told it that the type is this. Don't go looking that up on MSDN because you'll have an awful job finding it because it doesn't exist. Because it's referring to this, which is just a simple enumeration, and it's defining a name and the value, which means that we can now put these in either as the abbreviations, or you can put the full name in. One gotcha that I spent a lot of head scratching over trying to discover what's going on. If you put spaces in here, it will break. Don't know why, but it does. What this means is that we now go to, yeah, my sense of humor does leave a lot to be desired. So you can now just give it the hive name and it works much simpler. And you start to get some other goodies as well, because the hive name is automatically validated. So HKLL is a deliberate mistake, and it will break and tell you that it can't work with that. And you can't read it, but it is actually giving you the correct list of names as you would expect from a PowerShell commandlet.
It doesn't state the full HK local machine.
It doesn't. You're correct. Have a book. Who is it? That's my wetlands down nearly. EasyJet will love me. Yeah, it. I don't know why it doesn't pick that one up. I suspect it's because you've already defined something against that number, so it's just picking one, the first one of each pair. So if you think back to the code, the second, we defined HKLM, and then that's just effectively a redefinition of it. It works when you use it, but I suspect that it's just picking up the first one when it shows the list. Unless anybody knows any better, that's the guess I'm going with. So we had a default to HKLM. We didn't set that. That's just standard with the WMI class. So we're picking up that. And that gets us a little bit further on. The hive is one of the primary bits of information that we need. So with a PowerShell module that you're writing, a script module, you've got a whole bunch of things that you can decorate the parameters with to make them mandatory and so on. Most of those are available through CDXML. I can't think of what isn't, but I'm not going to guarantee that everything is. So all you need to do is add that line in, and I'll show you that in the code. And it's there. It's just slightly different. You know, if you're doing a function, it's mandatory equals dollar true. In this case, it's is mandatory, and it's just the text, not the PowerShell variable. And that's all you need to make the parameter mandatory. Just use it as before. The reason I'm using the get registry string is it's the easiest one to demo. The final module that you get in the code drop, that will have all of the methods actually working for you. And there's a full demo text file for running through and playing with it. If you don't put the parameter in, it will prompt. At least it will if I can type. Behaves just exactly as you would expect. It also won't allow you to get away without putting a value in. So for very little effort, you're putting a lot of functionality in, and it's working exactly the same way as your PowerShell modules or your script modules. You can add validation onto some other parameters. So we'll look at that. Validate null or empty. You remember that from validating parameters in advanced functions. You can create sets to validate against. You can validate against ranges. Most of the standard validation techniques are available in exactly the same way. The only trick is getting the XML correct, and there are hundreds of examples in the Server 2012.
Just out of curiosity, can you do a git command on one of those dot definition just to see what the actual code looks like that it generates?
Basically it's generating a huge big function that
all the validate app.
Yeah. So, works as before. If we leave the subkey out, it's basically telling you that it needs it. Standard sort of error messages. And if you don't give it a value name, if you don't give it a parameter, it will attempt to carry forward, but so would a standard function, and you'll get a non-zero return value. Look at some of the other methods and a couple of the gotchas in there, just to finish up. So the download that you'll get, that demo module.txt, will have a demo for all of the commandlets. And if we look at the final code, there is an awful lot of it by the time you, so 650 lines, by the time you get to the putting all of the methods in. Cut and paste works very nicely for you. The couple of tricks with dealing with just need to be a little careful dealing with byte data. That can get interesting, which I'll demonstrate for you. I'll be there for a while, so we'll just go through this. So we've now got all of them, and you're asking for the definition?
Yeah.
There you go.
I was curious how the enumerators were done.
Yeah, so we go up to the top.
It doesn't like create a belt.
Standard. When it creates the function, it's just translating it into the standard PowerShell function for you.
And in terms of the enumeration values, when you say something is the given hex value, when we're generating this function, we're actually doing some .NET code generation.
You create a enumer class.
Yeah.
I mean, you create an enumerator basically in C Sharp.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I was wondering if there's a way to do that in PowerShell, so that's why I was curious.
Yeah. So it's probably worth you while sitting, trawling through this, comparing it to the XML, and then you can track down what's doing what.
The parameter name time in brackets, is there a reason why that is? Subkey and hi?
You mean here?
Yeah.
That's the way the system generates it. It will, I'm assuming that it's to allow you to have odd characters in your variable names. There are other things that produce similar looking functions or similar looking parameter lines when you actually run them. So if you run a workflow and look at the function that generates, that's a similar thing. And a lot of the things that are auto-created end up looking like that.
Right, this is an example of when we designed the CDXML commandlets, our goal was you can point these at an untrusted server and ask it for its metadata for CDXML. So you can still safely manage a server, even if it might have been compromised, using commandlets over CDXML. Now, if that server is compromised, it might be giving you back parameter names or enum names that might try to have PowerShell script injection or anything along that lines. So where you see things that look like content that you might not normally write by hand, that's because that's a way of safely escaping what a server might send back. You'll also notice that when it's calling into any of the PowerShell commandlets, like get WMI object or get some instance, they're also fully qualified with the module name. So you're safe using this style of commandlet development, even against a malicious server's metadata.
Thank you. Finally got understand that now.
So what happens if my compromised server returns the file path as a parameter name? Because if I do like dollar braces file path parentheses equals some text, then I'm actually setting that text as the content of the file.
And yeah, we also do additional validation on that. So we make sure that parameter names can only come back with the appropriate character sets.
Thank you. The other thing to remember is that if you're creating these CDXML modules, the WMI class must be present on the any remote machine that you're hitting. It doesn't put it there for you. So quickly running through this, get registry key, we'll return the names as you would expect. Seen it getting in values. When you're looking at the values, they come back as the names and the types, and I haven't found a way to actually combine them within the XML. It may be possible to do it, I'm not sure. Everything I've tried hasn't worked so far. So a little bit of brute force, which is always a good answer, solves that. You can work with D words, and you can change those. I'm just going to really blip through these quickly because you can play with str's content later. Multi-strings are interesting and just as easy to work with. You can work with, so you get it back as an array, you can have bytes, you can work with those. That's the only, remember I said working with the binary one was a little difficult. You just need to treat it as a byte array when it comes back, and you can play with that quite happily. And that is how you commandlettize the registry. Quite simple, a lot of cut and paste, a little bit of head scratching here and there. The white paper that I mentioned is available on the Microsoft website. I've also put a copy in the download here for you. It describes the XML schema for this stuff, gives lots of good examples, and I would recommend that you have a play with it. And if you've got people struggling with WMI, wrap it up like this and make it easier for them. Thank you. So anybody got any questions?
Where's the download?
Where's the download of the...
What were you just talking about?
What, the white paper or this code?
This code.
This code is on here. It will be part of the download from the summit.
Okay.
If you want it before then, I'm quite more than willing to negotiate a deal. Question at the back.
Which version of the start demo script are you using to...
A very old one.
Okay. Yeah, I was looking on your blog. I saw posts in
2007. Yeah, it probably is that one. I think I borrowed it from Jeffrey a long time ago,
yeah,
and one of these days he'll ask for it back.
Okay, yeah, so I was like, man, that's awesome.
It it makes life easier for doing this sort of thing, because I cannot type and talk at the same time. Any more?
When would you use this instead of the PowerShell provider?
When would I use this instead of the PowerShell provider? Personally, most of the time, because I prefer commandlets to providers. That's a personal preference. If you're happy working with the provider, use the provider. Though using the provider remotely is a lot more difficult. So you get a sim session parameter automatically with this stuff, so that makes using it against remote machines an awful lot easier.
And I guess another point too is that his module is one thing, but he's pointing out a technique, right? So that was 600 lines of pretty easy XML, a little bit dense, but really not that hard. Compare that to if you were to write PowerShell script commandlets for all of these sim classes, that would have been thousands of lines in all likelihood. And then with all the error handling that you'd have to do, that's all been done as part of the PowerShell infrastructure. So if you've got somebody who's struggling with, let's say, a namespace or things where commandlets or provider don't already exist, this is an awesome option to help that out.
How would that work with PS Drive, though, where you can do HKLM colon, and then you've got the functionality to use a set item and a set item property?
I think the example would be when that doesn't exist,
right?
If you're dealing with like a VMM object model or a SCOM or something else,
right,
or they don't have commandlets, this is a way to easily make them and improve your management experience.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. No more? Okay. Buttons pressed. Off.